I search for life's meaning, enslaved by the world and my greed. Then the door of my prison was opened by love, for the ransom was paid, I was free. I'm free from the fear of tomorrow.
Says the kingdom of God is righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. The kingdom of God is, not was, not will be, is joy, peace, righteousness. If it has to be defined as the kingdom of God, there are three components that tells you whatever is happening, whatever you're doing, wherever you are, is a kingdom of God. If it has to be called the kingdom of God, if you have to check against your checklist, would this be the kingdom of God or otherwise? Your checklist should have righteousness, peace, and joy. Somebody sang a song, I think the singer sang one of his songs this morning. Righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. That is the kingdom, or this is the kingdom of God. But in the course of that kingdom, I want us to pick on one component that forms the kingdom. Remember, I said the kingdom of God is defined in those three aspects: righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. But let's single out this joy factor. The joy factor. When God created the heavens and the earth, one of his governments in heaven was a department in charge of worship, church of joy, was a department in church of celebration. The atmosphere of heaven was filled with joy. And you know, there was an angel that was assigned to be in charge of joy. We call him Lucifer. When he fell down, perverted the gift of God in his life and formed what we call today the kingdom of darkness. Perverted joy. But the kingdom of God is built on that platform of joy. Genesis says, in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth, and the earth was without form and void, covered with darkness, but the Spirit of God hovered above the waters. And God said, let there be light, and there was light. But I like the part that says, and God saw that the light was good. It brought joy to him. And the second day, the same thing the Bible talks about. God saw that what he had created was good. It brought joy to him. The contention that has been right from Genesis to where we are today has been between what brings joy and what brings sadness, what grieves God. The Bible says God created the heavens and the earth. The first day what he did brought him joy. The second day what he did brought him joy. The third day brought him joy. The fourth and the fifth and the sixth day brought him joy. On the seventh day, just before he rested, he noticed that something was not completing the joy that he had seen from day one to day five. He had created man in his own image and likeness. And supposedly, he thought that the garden with everything in it will bring joy to the man. But the Bible says the man looked at everything that God gave him. Looked at the birds of the air, looked at the vegetation, looked at the wild animals, looked at the rivers, the freshness of the air in the garden. And the Bible says God would come in the evening just to fellowship with man. But he noticed that something was not completing the joy of the man. And for the first time we hear God say, it's not joyful, it's not good for a man to be alone. I'll bring him joy, I'll bring something that will complete his joy. And the Bible says he caused a man to sleep, picked the rib from his side and formed a woman and brought to the man. And the man looked at the woman and said, wow, my joy is complete. This is now. And I'm imagining how Adam would express it like I would. This is now the bone of my bones. And every woman should know that. Any man should look at you and say, this is now. If your man doesn't say, this is now, you need to go back to the Garden of Eden for formation. Because there is a defect. A complete woman will bring joy to the man. Of course, forget about that. So man said, now this is bone of my bones. And from then God stopped creating and he rested. Complete in his heart, fulfilled. Said, I'll finish my work. Until sorrow stepped into the Garden of Eden through the deception. Through the deception, did God really say it? And of course, finally, the man questioned the authority of God's word. Changed his mind from what God had said. Picked the fruit that was forbidden. The Bible says he was sent away from the presence of God. And when he left his presence, he lost the joy of life. And the man began to toil and to struggle. And throughout the Bible, God has been trying to work on restoration of man. He's tried to bless man, give him a kingdom, give him children, blessed him with good things. The intention of God was to bring joy to man. And throughout the Bible, man got it in bits and pieces until Jesus came. The voice came from heaven to a maiden girl whose name was Mary and say, hey, the highly favored one, And Mary, of course, wanted to know what those greetings would mean to a girl that is exposed to Mary. And you know what it means when a woman, when a girl is in her last stages of planning for a wedding. She doesn't want any man coming. Doesn't want anything like, I love you from different quarters. And Mary is just at the point where a wedding is just about. They have done all they needed to do. Everybody knew that Joseph was going to get married to Mary. And here comes this voice in the name of an angel and say, hey, the beloved one, you're highly favored. And he said, what kind of greetings would that be? You know the story. But I love the words of Mary in Luke chapter 1, verse 38. After she's heard the words of the angel, she said these words, I surrender. Let it be unto me. He said, behold, I am the handmaiden of the Lord. Let it be done to me according to what you've said. And the angel left. She accepted the word of the angel as the word of the Lord. She didn't want a confirmation. She took that word and say, hey, I conceive this word. I consider this word to be a word from the Lord. Mary agreed with God's word in spite of her dreams, a vision, a marriage and a wedding, in spite of the society and the challenge of the culture then, that a woman would not be seen having a child in a womb without the proper structure that led to that realization. Mary said, let it be unto me. I take this as a word from the Lord. She surrendered to the will of God against her own will. A wish, a desire, a will, a dreams. Like every other human being was, to get married, be a good wife, exposed to a wonderful boy, a loving man, whose name was Joseph. And Mary was longing for the day when she would say, honey, yes, I do. But God interrupted into that program, and of course, you know, she surrendered a will. She resigned her plans and allowed God's will to prevail. She didn't mind. Of course, she knew the consequences. Because, like we know, the Bible talks about when Joseph noticed that Mary was expecting a baby, he planned and schemed to run away secretly, probably move to another city, probably get another girlfriend. And she had the right to do that because the culture then supported the position of Joseph. It took a divine intervention from the angel of God to say, hey, 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 Joseph, come back, boy, come back. Don't run away. This thing that you see in this girl is divine. It's of God. Please take your girl who is supposed to be your wife. Mary credited God's power to what he said. She believed. When God said, you will conceive, it doesn't matter your status, whether you are a virgin, whether you are single, God said it, I believe it, so it is settled. And she credited God and accepted. I'm sure the word of God overtook the feeling of shame. It overtook the feeling of loss. Mary was not thinking about, what about my parents? What about my spouse, my boyfriend? What about my dignity? What about me? I've kept myself as a girl. The rest of the girls are so excited about it. They admire me. They keep looking at me and Joseph walking around and they're like, baby, you got it. Some people wish they would marry Joseph. But here comes Mary. You are the privileged one. But in spite of all that, Mary gave into the will of God. Her faith was fully on that prophetic word. She took that word and said, everything else can get out of my way. I take the word of prophecy. Mary suspended her human reasoning. She never took another minute to think about, humanly speaking, what would people say? After all, the messenger, supposedly an angel, spoke to me in a form of a vision. I can't put a finger to it. If anybody was to question the integrity of the message, if anybody was to take me to the court of law, if I was to sit in the council of elders and be asked to give a detailed report on how this happened, there was no exhibit. There was nothing to prove other than an angel came to me in a form of a vision and said, you will be pregnant. For heaven's sake, who will take that in a culture? There were no medics or hospitals to check whether she was virgin. The only test of a woman's virginity was based on a first night with a man. They would take white sheets, give it to her from her parents. And the first night of an encounter with a husband, a virginity will be broken. And in the morning, the blood that spill out of that, on that white garment, it will be wrapped together. And the first thing in the morning, a messenger will wrap those things together and rush it to, I'm looking for something. Yes. That white comment that was used that night, the first night with the husband, with the blood that spilled out of the virgin girl, in the morning, it will be wrapped together and sent to the parents of the girl. They will keep it as long as both of you would live. In any occasion where the man would want to divorce the woman, the condition would be simple. We don't mind you divorcing our girl, but on one condition. Take this sheet, take this piece of cloth, and return her virginity. And then you can bring our girl back. And so it was an hard task. But nevertheless, Mary did not consider that. She said, you know what? Let it be done to me. But what gives me a lot of joy is that when Mary received the word from the angel, she didn't question or doubt the voice of God. There was no questioning. There was no position. There was no argument. She compelled herself to obey. She said, "Sir, let it be so unto me." And then, of course, she did what Corinthians says. 1 Corinthians, 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 5. She dealt with every thought. She pulled down everything that would think otherwise. Every thought, every argument. The Bible says, "And in so much we refute arguments and theories and reasonings and every proud and lofty thing that sets itself up against the true knowledge of God. And we lead every thought and purpose away captive into the obedience of Christ, the Messiah." I'm sure Mary impressed that truth and captured every thought that would think otherwise. Ladies and gentlemen, what the Lord gave us this week, this year, is the season of bringing forth. Mary becomes a role model, a point of reference, that in spite of your condition, in spite of how impossible the situation would look, in spite of your status, Virgin Mary, unemployed you, a single mother you, an illiterate you, an orphaned you, a stranger you, if you receive the word of God without questioning it, if you surrender to the word from the Lord, if you take that prophetic word as a word from the Lord, in spite of the angel, the Bible says, "Believe in the Lord your God and you shall be established. Believe the prophet and you shall flourish, prosper, see results, see the manifestation." If you receive the word of this season that you will bring forth, I guarantee you in the name of the Lord that in the course of this year, that word of bringing forth, in spite of Joseph, that would automatically lead to the bringing forth. If you conceive the word of the Lord, I guarantee you, you will bring forth. Amen. In the name of Jesus. Amen. What blesses my heart is chapter 1, verses 45 of the book of Luke. And this is where the joy factor comes in. "Bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. I will bless the Lord with all my soul and all that is within me. I will bless." Join me, everybody, say, "I will bless the Lord with all my soul and all that is within me. Bless his holy name." name. Would you lift your hands as we say these words? He has done great things. If you believe it, say, He has done great things. Hallelujah. Everybody open your mouth, say with me, Lord, you have done great things, yeah. Oh, great. Just think about it. And Mary blessed the Lord. And she said these words, blessed and happy to be envied is she. She personalized, she didn't say he, because she was a woman. She talked to herself and said, hey, and blessed, happy are you, Mary. You are to be envied, baby girl. Why? Because you have believed. Mary is talking to Mary. Amen. And David encouraged himself in the Lord. And Mary takes the words of prophecy from the angel and began to prophesy to our own self by affirming those words and say, hey, Mary, blessed and happy to be envied is you, Mary, who believed that there would be a fulfillment of the things that was spoken to her from the Lord. And she goes on to say, and Mary said, my soul magnifies and extols the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God, my Savior. For he has looked upon the low station and humiliation of his handmaid. For behold, from now, amen. For behold, listen, Mary has not even felt the signs of a pregnant woman. It's just after the word just came. Mary has not begun to feel changes in the system. But she said, I believe. I take it as a word from the Lord. Let it be to me, Lord, according to your word. And she said, I bless you, Lord. I celebrate. Thank you. I consider it done. And she said, from now on, all generations of all ages will call me blessed and declare me happy and to be envied. Remember, Mary is still talking to Mary about the prophetic word over the life of Mary. For he who is almighty has done great things for me, and holy is his name, to be venerated in his purity, majesty and glory. Majesty, worship his majesty. Unto Jesus be all glory, honor, and praise. Majesty. Kingdom authority flow from his throne unto his own, and his anthem is raised. I know where you're lost. So exalt, lift up on high the name of Jesus. Magnify, come glorify Christ Jesus the King. Majesty, worship his majesty. Jesus, who died, now glorified, King of all kings. And Mary sang a song of joy. And then the angel goes ahead and says, "Hey, baby, by the way, your cousin Elizabeth is with a baby. She's pregnant for 6 months." And of course, Mary, now listen, Mary has not even begun to feel the kicks of a baby. The baby has not yet formed, but the girl is singing. His mercies, his compassion and kindness towards the miserable and the afflicted is on those who fear him with godly reverence from generation to generation and age to age. He has shown strength and made mighty with his arm. He has scattered the proud and the haughty, and by the imagination and purpose and design of their hearts, he has put down the mighty from their thrones and exalted those of low decree. He has filled and satisfied the hungry. Hey, now listen, Mary is not just describing or sharing a poem or singing a song. She's actually expressing what she's conceived. Don't go away, boy. She's just expressing what she's conceived. You know what? This word she conceived was described, is now being described by all these words. Oh boy. Mary's conceiving the word whose description is in the song. He has filled and satisfied the hungry. That is Jesus in the womb already. And the rich, he has sent away empty-handed, without a gift. He's laid on all knees, servant Israel. That's the word in the womb. To help him, to espouse his cause in remembrance of mercy. Even as he promised to our forefathers, of course to Abraham and his descendants forever. And Mary remained with Elizabeth for about 3 months. Those days, people still had time to socialize, visiting a friend for 3 months. The word in Mary the Savior in Mary, the solution in Mary, the healing in Mary, wrapped in the word of prophecy from the angel, is now changing the language of Mary into a song. And then, of course, Elizabeth responds. But look at this. Look at this. Look at this. When Mary arrives in Elizabeth's house and said, "Hey, shalom, girl," instead of Elizabeth responding to say, "Hi," the baby in the womb responded. I pray that the Lord will make you pick this one. When Mary said to Elizabeth, "Hi, girl," the baby in the womb responded, and Elizabeth describes it in this manner, that the child in the womb leaped with joy. Now listen, the conversation is no longer between Mary and Elizabeth. The conversation is between two seasons that complements each other. The conversation is between two prophetic words to Elizabeth, courtesy of a prophet, a priest rather, and to Mary, courtesy of the angel. And Mary's mouth has been taken over by the prophetic word, and Elizabeth's mouth has been taken over by the prophetic word, and the two prophetic words are having a transaction in the spirit. I want you to consider three things as I bring this to a climax. Joy. 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 The kingdom of God is righteousness, peace, and joy. The kingdom of God, the transaction in the kingdom of God, the doings of God, the involvements of God, righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. Look at me, friends. When you look at the Bible throughout, any divine transaction, any divine transaction, the kingdom of God is transacted on the platform of joy. If you have to receive, to own, and bring to a realization any prophetic word that God has spoken, the womb of conception, the environment of sowing that seed, the conducive environment that guarantees results, has to be an environment of joy. The things of God are received with joy. Listen to me. The greatest weapon, and I want you to take my word seriously, the greatest weapon of the enemy against anything you do with or for God is to fight the joy in it. Look at any challenge you've ever gone through. The focus is to frustrate the joy in what you're doing. Be it in marriage, in your place of work, be it in the church, be it in your service. Look at anybody who quit a job. They lost the joy of it. Look at anybody who quit marriage. They lost the joy. Look at anybody who quit service to God in form of serving in a ministry, in a department, leading a group of people. They lost the joy. When you lose the joy of the Lord, everything becomes heavy. Joy is the grace of service. When joy lifts, duty comes on board. And when you are on duty, everything is heavy. I want to recommend to you, never force anybody to anything they have lost a joy in. You will kill the institution and you will kill the person. The beauty of anything you do is the joy behind it. When you lose joy in your marriage, marriage begins to grumble. When you lose joy in your business, business begins to grumble. When you lose joy in your department begins to go down. When you lose joy in your prayer life, prayer begins to go down. When you lose joy in the church, church becomes too far. 2 hours becomes forever. When you lose joy over life, you always want to die. You love bad news. When you lose joy, everything in life becomes heavy. I want you to note, the things of God are conceived in the womb of joy. God, protect, fight, preserve your environment of joy. Victories are defined by joy. Anything you've lost joy over, you've lost it. You lose it by losing joy. When you lose the joy of something, you've lost it. When you lose the joy of fighting, you've lost the battle. When you lose the joy of service, you've lost service. When you lose the joy of leadership, you've lost leadership. If I lose the joy of ministry today, I will close this church the next minute. Joy is the womb of conception. God transacts his business in an environment of joy. You never receive anything from God away from joy. No wonder Paul says, I recommend to you, rejoice in the Lord always. Make sure the environment is conducive for conception at any given time. And again, I say, rejoice. Ladies and gentlemen, for the time I've been in this service, I've noticed 2 things that are very common. When a brother, when a sister begins to lose the joy because of joy. God transacts his business and in an environment of joy. I want to recommend to you, guard joy, follow joy, walk with joy. I hope you keep that word joy. When you lose joy, everything becomes heavy. When you lose joy, home becomes too far. When you lose joy, taking a shower is a bother. Talk to me. When you lose joy, waking up is a problem. When you lose the joy of your place of work, Monday, you wake up like you're going to the mortuary. When you lose joy, cooking for your husband makes you feel like a slave. When you lose joy, 2 years ago, I flew to West Africa, a country called Gambia. We use Ethiopian Airlines. And we flew from here, Nairobi, Addis Ababa, Ethiopia. And then we took a flight from Ethiopia to Senegal. Man, we went across Ethiopia, Sudan, Mali, I don't know which other country. 9 hours on the air, right in the air. We slept, we had breakfast in the plane. I think we landed a little bit in Mali somewhere. Somewhere in the bush, some airport somewhere in the bush. We had lunch and dinner. By the time we arrived in Gambia, in Senegal, where I was supposed to connect a flight to Gambia, the flight had left. So I was either to sleep in the airport or go to some guest house somewhere. Out of my mindset from the village, I walked out of the airport, looked for a guest house, and slept. At midnight, I had a knock on my door. When I opened the door, the police, with guns, they are looking for me. How they knew where I am, God knows. But the message was, we noticed that somebody left the airport and entered into Senegal without a visa. I was supposed to have a visa to have walked out of the airport to enter into a country called Senegal. But forget about that. I've had invitations to go back to Gambia over and over again since the last 2 or 3 years, I suspect. But when I think about 9 hours on the plane, I lose the joy. I'm looking for a shortcut. I'm told there's a shortcut. You can leave from here to Nigeria and then to Gambia through Kenya Airways. I'm considering that. 9 hours took away the joy of life. When you lose joy, everything becomes a bother. When you lose joy, what you celebrated yesterday, you begin accusing today. When you lose joy, what you told everybody, you begin to contradict. The things of God are conceived in an environment of joy. Number two, joy brings what we call the nowness of a prophetic word. Joy brings what we call the nowness of a prophetic word. The kingdom of God is. The kingdom of God is. The kingdom of God is now, present, tangible. The kingdom of God is joy. You make a prophetic word now. You cause it to bring forth by joy. When you entertain the joy in it, you make it a now present word. Lack of joy postpones a prophetic word to the future. Joy brings it from the future and makes it a reality now. May you receive joy. Amen. I say, may you receive joy. Amen. I say, may you receive joy. Amen. 1 Samuel chapter 2, verses 1. We have the story of joy. Mary says, let it be unto me. And she began to rejoice. And the word became a now word, courtesy of joy. Elizabeth prayed and said, my heart exalts and triumphs in the Lord. My horn, my strength is lifted up in the Lord. My mouth is no longer silent, for it is opened wide over my enemies. Because I rejoice in your salvation. There is none holy like the Lord. There is none beside you. There is no rock like our God. Talk no more so very proudly. That's the response of the man who thought that Anna was overwhelmed with drinking. Anna responded with joy. Joy is an environment that creates a nowness that allows a prophetic word to be realized immediately. Before you could feel it, you can joy it, if that is English. Before you can feel it, you can joy it. Finally, number three, joy denies the enemy access to your prophetic word. Joy denies the enemy access to your prophetic word. Ladies and gentlemen, I have an announcement. If you can rejoice over it, you can keep it. If you can rejoice over it, you can keep it. The enemy will never touch it until he has touched your joy. Look at me, I've removed my glasses. Be careful, look at me everybody. Be careful of anything that threatens your joy. It's the entry point of the enemy. And by the way, just to let you know, did you know that the devil is still a thief? Are you still aware of that? Did you know that the devil is a thief? Now listen, you don't steal bad things. You steal good things. A thief doesn't break into homes that have nothing. A thief doesn't come to your house to steal tissue paper. When a thief comes, he doesn't go to the house of a caretaker. He goes to the main house. A thief doesn't come to steal your socks. Always remember that we still have a thief. We still have a liar. He comes to steal, kill, and destroy. That is mission. If you can keep joy, you can keep your victory. I've said this over and over, but let me just repeat it for purpose of clarity. David is the only king. David is the only king who never lost any battle. You know why? The boy fought with joy. Those of you who are pastors, and those of you who will be pastors, and those of you that God is calling you to ministry, I want to give you a free advice. Whatever happens in your life, in your ministry, don't lose your joy. If you keep your joy, you will keep the enemy at the gate. Whatever happens, if the church bangs down, come singing. You lose nothing until you've lost the joy of it. joy shuts the enemy away from your blessings. Joy comes in the morning. Morning is defined as a new season when a prophetic word comes. I want to recommend to you this morning, impress the culture of David, the man who went to the battlefield with a guitar. The boy went to fight the army with singers in front. The man who sang his way to victory. The man who fight battles. Listen, lose a friend, don't let them take your joy. Lose a job, keep your joy. I would even dare lose your wife, lose your wife, lose your husband, don't lose your joy. Once the enemy has taken away joy, it can penetrate anywhere and finally kill you. Your joy is your defense. Your joy is your master key. If the devil closes one door, joy will open another. Never let anybody, the greatest enemy of your life, listen to me, the greatest enemy of your life is not the man, the woman who takes away your money. It's not the man who takes away your wife, your husband. It's not the woman who lied to you. It's not the boyfriend who dumped you. It's not the boss who sacked you. It's not the money you lost. It's not the loved one you lost. The greatest enemy you have in your life is anything and anybody whose focus is to distort your joy. Jesus hung on the cross. But Hebrews says he considered not what he went through because there was joy for the joy of what was set before him. He endured the cross. Hebrews 12. Hebrews 12, 2. Look away from all that will distract. Look away, turn away from anything that will distract you. Look at me before we read that scripture. Look at me. Everybody look at me. Everybody look at me. I don't care what level of relationship you have with the so-called a friend. If you notice they are beginning to interfere with your joy, I want to recommend to you, kiss them goodbye. You're only relevant courtesy of the joy in my life. I'm giving you a remedy. Because the people that hurt you most, take away, look away from all these distractions. Turn to Jesus, who is the leader and the source of our faith, giving the first incentive for our belief. And is also, and he is also its finisher, bringing it to maturity and perfection. He, Jesus, to say, for the joy of obtaining the prize that was set before him, he endured. Say that word with me. Come on, say with a feeling. He endured the cross, despising and ignoring the shame. And now he's seated at the right hand of the throne of God. If you want to remain on the throne of your word, of your season, if you want to write on the wings of your prophetic word, if you want to enjoy your life daily, despise, ignore, endure anything that will take away your joy. Keep your joy and life, and live your prophetic life daily. I finish by saying, learn to walk in, but also learn to walk out. Walk into joy, walk away from anything that distracts your joy. Nobody is worth your joy. Nobody, nothing, nothing, and I absolutely mean nothing is worth your joy. Listen, friend, when you lose joy, you begin to die slowly. You get into depression. You enter into blood pressure. You begin to suffer. And before you know it, you begin to die. Attach your joy to the price of your calling. Let Jesus be the principle of your pursuit in life. Impress people based on the direction you're going. But listen, keep your joy. And the church say, and the church say,
amen.
And the church say,
amen. And now